Okay, so question 8, give the actual ground state electron configuration for copper using the complete form. So to find the electron configuration, we first need to divide the table into different sections. So this light blue section is denoted as the S block. This green section is the P block. And the middle transition metals are the D block. And the last two rows is the F block. So to find the electron configuration, we start at hydrogen. And then we just move from left to right down the periodic table until we get to our desired element. So in this case, it is copper, which is found right here, atomic number 29. Okay, so as we move down the periodic table, we want to first write down our row number, and then we want to write the block letter. So whether or not it's S, P, D, or F. But once we get to the D block, it's going to be the row number minus 1. And then when we get to the F block, it's the row number minus 2. So this will make more sense once I start showing how to find the electron configuration of copper. So let's start off at hydrogen. Its row number is 1. Its block number is S, and then in the 1s orbital, there's hydrogen and helium, so there's 2. So you write 1s2. And then you do the same thing going down to the next row, 2s2. And then moving over, we're in the 2p. And then the number of elements there is 6. And then to the next row, 3s2, and then 3p6, and then the next row down, 4s2, and then counting up to the copper, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, so 3D9. So at this point, when you get to your electron configuration, it's typically done if it's not like a transition metal, but it's a little more not complicated, but you just need to think about a few things about which orbitals are more stable compared to other orbitals. So for example, fill D10 orbitals are more stable than when they're partially filled. So now that we know this, we see that our electron configuration ends in 3D9. So what happens is that one of the electrons in the 4s2 orbital is actually moved up to 3D10 to form 3D10. So therefore, we can rewrite the electron configuration so that it is 4s1 and then 3d10. Okay, so let's see what the junior tutor said. Writing ground state electron configuration follows the off-bal principle. The off-bal principle states that electrons must fill the lowest energy shells first, and the electron configuration chart shown below shows off-bal's principle, and this chart will help us determine how to properly assign electrons of an element to their proper energy shells. Electron configurations are written using the principal quantum number n, followed by the orbital s, p, d, or f, with the total number of electrons written as a subscript. So this is another method that some people like to do. So this helps you get the order of the electron configuration. So if you write all of the s values in one column, all the p in one column, and then all the d orbitals in one column and the f, and then you kind of just move like diagonally like this, then you get 1s, 2s, and then 2p, 3s, 3p, 4s, 3d, 4p, 5s. So that's another way people do it as well. So before we can use the electron configuration chart, let's determine the number of electrons copper has. So there's 29 in its ground state. So when we'll write the configuration, we'll put all 29 electrons in orbitals around the nucleus of the copper atom. Okay, so since s orbitals can only hold two electrons, the next two electrons for copper go to the 2s. So they do it like step by step. P orbital can hold 6, so they wrote it all down. The d orbital can hold 10. And then they mentioned that our expected electron configuration for copper would then be 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d9. They also wrote half-filled d5 and filled d10 orbitals provide extra stability to the atom. This makes copper an exception to Aufbau's principle. We adjust to this by making one of the 4s2 electrons jump to 3d9. This gives us the correct configuration of 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s1, 3d10. Yep, so this solution is correct. I think we have time for one more question.